Hey everyone, welcome to a drive-by review of the Canon M50, one of the newest mirrorless options from Canon this year, and their obvious attempt at taking back some of the successful mirrorless market share from the other companies out there. And Canon promises with this camera to, one, listen to the consumer, us, and two, improve on connectivity and video. So the question is, one, did they do what they vowed and promised? And two, is it worth your hard-earned cash? Well, let's find out today and start off by looking at the specs in the M50. Inside this camera, we have a 24 megapixel APS-C sized sensor, and they use the EFM lens mounting system. Now, currently Canon doesn't have very many native lens options for that mounting system, but there is an adapter out there that lets you use the EF and EFS lenses out there from Canon already. We have the dual pixel autofocusing system we've come to know and love from Canon. It's quite snappy and accurate, and it's used in this camera in both stills and up to 1080p video. It's not used in the 4K. We'll talk about that more later. They put in the DigiGate processor, a brand new powerful processor out from Canon, and the OLED electric viewfinder is 2.36 million dots, which for me is one of the reasons this kind of stands above similarly priced cameras at the beginner level. It also has a 1.04 million dot variangle LCD, the one that can flip out and be spun around if you want to do those selfie shots. It can go up to 7.4 frames per second in burst when you're in autofocus continuous mode, and it can go up to 10 frames per second when you're in autofocus single shot. It can shoot 4K up to 24 frames per second in ultra high definition video. However, with that video mode, there is an additional 1.7 times crop, and you have to use it in video mode. You can't use it in any of the other modes. It can also shoot 1080 up to 60 frames per second and 720 up to 120 frames per second in HD video. It has Wi-Fi connectivity and NFC with Bluetooth, which is awesome, except when you come down to the battery life at 235 shots per battery charge, it kind of makes you wonder how much you're going to be using those capabilities with the stock battery. Now, on that note, I kind of see the M50 as a powerhouse entry-level camera with a ton of capabilities in photo and video modes. However, that battery life really limits how much you can do, especially considering if you're going to go out and tripod it, the tripod mount actually blocks the battery door. You know, when you open it, you can't do that without taking off your mount. And that battery life that comes stock with the camera is something like a 800 milliampere hour battery. Luckily, Wasabi Power, with their Wasabi Power Packs, continues to outdo the stock batteries, and they offer a really cost-effective option where you get two batteries that are at 1100 milliampere hours. So this will last a lot longer. You get two of them for a cheap price, and it's going to make things a lot more reasonable when you're out there, especially trying to do video, maybe 4K or 1080 at high frame rates. It's going to last a lot longer if you just give it that boosted battery. If you're interested in that, I'll post a link in the description below, and you can check that out for yourself. Now, one of the main benefits there is from utilizing a camera that has an APS-C sized sensor is that it's going to be lighter and more compact, easier to carry around and take on the go if you want to do a quick project or you just need something that's convenient to pack. This comes in at only 351 grams on the body and dimensions of 116 millimeters tall, 88 millimeters wide, and 59 millimeters in girth. And when you take a look at it, it's extremely compact, and I always have liked Canon's ability to create ergonomic grips on their cameras that fits comfortably in the hand. And you know, there's a lot of opinions out there on the other competitors and how good or bad they create their camera models, but it always comes down to personal opinion. And in this one, it's compact. They did a good job at using that particular benefit of this size sensor camera, and they've really used it well with the kit lens, as the kit lens has that compact locking option, and it's so lightweight. A lot of plastic going on in the camera and the lens body, but that's kind of to be expected. And it really comes down to, is the lens still smooth? Does it do its functioning correctly? Does it take good shots? Now, taking a look at the design elements of this camera, you can see that in general, Canon's kept pretty close to a similar model as far as where they're going to place the dial and where they're going to place the buttons. The record button is probably the only thing I don't really care for on here, but luckily you can change that in the settings to be the trigger instead of this little teeny red button that's hard to find, especially when you want to stop recording. For some reason, it becomes 10 times harder to find. There's also an HDMI port over on the right side, and then on the left side, exciting, there is a microphone port. And the awesome thing about this is I've heard it's actually pretty decent at recording internal audio, so I'm excited to test that out with some microphone options down the line. And stay tuned for that. The fully articulating LCD display is a welcome feature that honestly at this point I think should be in every single entry-level camera option out there, just because it's so heavily used by YouTubers and vloggers, and it's just something that's nice to have available in case you want to be able to do that. Now, it's awesome that they included 4K into this camera, but it's bizarre that they decided to basically castrate it, because it's 4K without the dual pixel autofocusing system, and it also has a 1.7 times crop on top of the APS-C sensor crop that happens just from not being full frame, from being a smaller sensor size. And in effect, what happens is you just get a much more zoomed in image of what you're taking a video of. And you can see that here. Here's a shot of this image just taken in 1080p. And then here's the same exact placement of the camera and lens when you're in 4K mode. Now, when it comes to the autofocusing that is available in 4K mode, it's contrast detect, but it's almost like going back to the 1990s with a kind of hunt and peck mode. And the only reason you'd ever want to do that is if you're making like another Blair Witch Project movie. But even that was intentionally placed out of focus, in focus type camera work. So you wouldn't want unexpected out of focus shots. And you definitely don't want hunting all the time. So really, in this camera, I believe if you're going to use 4K, you're probably going to be doing manual focus. And you know, that opens you up to a lot of cheaper option lenses if you're going to be doing a lot of that. But I just don't foresee people using a ton of 4K with this camera, but I will attempt to and see if I can mitigate how poorly the autofocus works when it's in contrast detect only. Now, I picked up this M50 with its 15-45 3.5 kit lens. And so I was really curious with that particular lens as my first option, how well it would perform in low light and how it would perform overall with its autofocus in all sorts of situations. And check this out, I was quite impressed with its dynamic range and color depth in a variety of situations. And I put it to the test, especially in this Christmas season, with low light situations in video and photography. And I found the autofocusing system to be snappier than when I was taking a look at the 80D. Now granted, I kind of just took the 80D to test really quickly out and put it against the autofocusing system in the dated A6000 just to see, has Canon really caught up to Sony? And in that test, which you can look at that video if you want to, but my opinion of the results was that the Canon was defeated quite soundly by the Sony A6000, even though it was a newer model camera. But in this case, this felt way snappier continuously throughout photo and video modes. And you can see here, even in these low light situations where the ISO was going up to 3000, 4000, 8000 at times, it was holding its autofocus ability at about the same rate, able to quickly go in and out, never losing focus, being completely accurate. The only time I saw some diminished capabilities was when I turned off the autofocus beam, which I did in this restaurant because it's just rude to blast people with this red light constantly. And in that case, it did have a harder time closer to its minimum focus range on this lens in capturing autofocus on the first attempt. But, you know, with that in mind, I wouldn't expect too much more with an entry-level camera with a 3.5 lens and an APS-C size sensor. I mean, even with the A6000 and a similarly spec'd lens, I would expect it to be about the same type of give and take with the autofocus, where I had to try a couple times before I got the autofocusing system to just snap on to somebody without any extra light, without any flash or anything like that, without the autofocus beam. And you can judge for yourself whether any of these images are usable. I think one of the main things I was hearing was that once the ISO gets to about 3200 or so, it just starts becoming too grainy to really use the images. But here you go, you can see for yourself that here's some images at that ISO range, and here's also video in that ISO range. Now the connectivity is pretty awesome. There's definitely some complaints on the control app. For example, they do things kind of similar to what they did with the 4K, where when you're controlling the app with your cell phone, they don't let you do time lapse in that mode. They didn't want you to be able to do that, so you have to do it in the camera itself, things like that. But beyond that, it's pretty awesome that there's just a teeny bit of lag in the live view, and you can control autofocus, you can control your settings, you can take video, you can take that family shot without getting in front of the camera and then running into the shot. You can compose the thing from afar, and it's pretty awesome how much they've added into the connectivity. And the one thing that Canon's boasting about is they've made this capability on their app and with the camera, with its connectivity, that it can constantly be sending to your phone all the images and all the video you've taken. Which is why when it comes to, let's say, like Instagrammers, YouTubers, and people that really operate almost solely on their phone, this is actually a pretty amazing innovation for those people, because the whole reason they're purchasing this camera is to have a better camera than their phone, but that is going to transition to their phone very easily. Now, so far with using the M50, I find it to be basically exactly what Canon was intending to do. And I think they succeed in various ways. I have a couple complaints about 4K, obviously, and some other things that they very obviously pulled back on this camera. But when it comes down to increasing connectivity, yes, they did that. When it comes down to answering what the consumer wants, You know, yeah, they did that in various ways, and I get why they're holding back on an entry-level camera. Now, when they first came out with this camera with its original pricing, I don't know, I mean, there's options at that price level that clearly beat the M50. But when it comes to where it's kind of headed towards in its value, I think we've hit a sweet spot at this point in the year of 2018 as it comes to a close, where this is actually a pretty good deal considering what it gives you in capabilities and what it can do, and also what the future may hold for the EFM mount technology and series of cameras that's going to come from Canon in the future as they really do try to push into the mirrorless market share. Now, I've got some lens options for this camera in the mail that I'm excited to test out. I'll also be doing some autofocusing tests and video tests in 4K, especially in the future, so stay tuned for those videos. If you yourself have any comments, requests, or suggestions in testing with this camera, please comment down below. And if you want to check out the camera for yourself, I'll put a link down in the description that you can check it out for yourself. But beyond that, thanks for tuning in, guys, and I'll see you next time on the next Drive-By Review. We'll be right back.